So X cannot be 1/2. So I know whatever else happens, X cannot be 1/2, right? But I also have a radical, so I know whatever is under it has to be bigger than or equal to 0. So X has to be bigger than -5. Now, this is a lot to process. I suggest, if you want, that you put it on a number line and take a look at it. It's everything bigger than -5 except 1/2, right? So when I look at it on the number line, I can see that two parts to my answer. I have the part from -5 to 1/2, and then I have the part from 1/2 to infinity. Anybody have a question about that? Okay, that's our domain. All right, now we're going to do a piecewise function. It's in three pieces, but there's only one break point, and that's at -1. So I'm going to go ahead and graph my squiggly line at -1. That's where all the action is, right there. Okay, what's that? That's an absolute value v, right? So I know it's going to look like this. It crosses right here in an open dot. And I want to keep the part to the right, so I'll just erase that. So that's the first thing you should have on your paper. Now, the middle one, do not be confused. The middle one very clearly says y equals 2 if x equals -1. Isn't that just the point, -1, 2? And then the bottom one is what shape? Y equals x minus 3, what shape is that? That's a linear with an intercept down at -3, right? So it's going to look like that. Again, an open dot. And I keep this part. So your picture should have had it. You can either have the squiggly or not. That's not necessary, but it doesn't hurt anything. You should have a dot. Like a check mark, and then this little gray thing down here. Is that okay with everybody? All right, then we gotta find all the asymptotes, poles, and intercepts for this. So what was the first thing you did with it? Factored it? Yep. The bottom will be x squared minus 7x plus 12. So 2x minus 4, x minus 3. Does that factoring look okay? Is that what you got? Mm-hmm. And then you notice what? Great excitement.
Hole.
You're going to have a hole because these are going to cancel, which means that your hole is going to be at x equals 3. Because that's the factor that canceled out. So what's the y? How do I find the y? Plug it in. So that's going to give me 6 over -2. Did you get 3 -3 for your whole?
Mm-hmm.
Now we also have asymptotes. We have a vertical asymptote at x equals 4. And we have a horizontal asymptote at y equals 1/2, which you could have gotten in the original problem also, x squared over 2x squared. So you could have gotten that right at the beginning if you wanted to. Now, my intercepts, by the way, I really, really was so kind to you. I put zeros in those points. I'm not doing that on your test. You need to know that an x-intercept is where I cross the y-axis, or the x-axis, so it's going to be something comma 0, and the y-intercept is where I cross the y-axis, so it's going to be 0 comma something. So if I put 0 in, get this out of here, if I put 0 in, it looks like I get 3/-8. -3/8 for my x or my y-intercept. And then if I set this equal to 0, I'm going to clear the denominator. Well, it still stays 0 when it times by 0. So it's -3. So my x-intercept is at -3. Anybody have a question about that? Okay, then once I fix the problem, finding our max and min was a little bit easier. Second calc, max, I got 2, 1. Is that what you got as your maximum?
No.
Okay, let's make sure I typed in my equation correctly. 2x cubed plus 5x squared minus 4.
So number
I ran out my calculator, so I'm using another one, and I didn't pay attention to how that was set up. So here, let me try again. Reciprocal has no zeros. No, the logarithmic has a zero. Remember, zeros are where we cross the x-axis. Exponential has no zeros, and logistic has no zeros. So if you have logistic, exponential, or reciprocal, you win. Right? Zeros are where we cross the x-axis. All right. This has end behavior that's up. That's what that means. As you go right, you go up. As you go left, you go up. What functions look like this? Absolute value, squaring. Those would be the two I would think of right off the bat. Right? Symmetry about the origin. In other words, they're odd. So when you visualize the picture, whatever's happening in quadrant one, or I guess in quadrant one, is also happening in quadrant three, right? They're like this, across from each other. So I think there are several of those. What do you have? What? Cubing is symmetric about the origin. What else? Linear. Reciprocal. And believe it or not, the sign. The sign also has symmetry about the origin. Because the bubble over here
we have another class and then we go to
all right. lower and upper bounds. Sine, definitely. Sine and cosine and resistance, right? Now, on the test, I might not say name one, I might say name them all. So make sure you are comfortable with all of your shapes, right? So you can visualize, okay, which ones are bounded. Which ones are bounded. All right, so that takes care of that. That is a grade, by the way. You're going to get a grade for that. So hopefully it's a good one. Now, as we were looking through these problems, and as you studied last night, or in the last couple days, what questions have you come up with that we need to look at on all those review materials that I gave you? I know some of you have spent time looking at them, and that makes me so happy. I know some of you have probably not looked at them at all, which makes me very sad and nervous about Monday. So, who found something? Come on, let's use our time wisely. We have a few more minutes before we'll have to go take this test next time we come together. So. I don't remember any of it. That is not a good thing to say. We need to remember all of it. Izzy?
Maybe do, I'll just give it to you. Yeah. Number three on the label. This one. The label.
So another. All right, she wants to graph another piecewise function. So I'll just use the one that's on the paper here. This is another one that has three pieces, but it only has one breaking point. So when I graph this, all of my dots are going to be at -2. Because that's the only place the graph is broken. Okay? So, what does that look like? That should be... Open dot, keep the left. So this time I'm erasing the check mark looking thing. Izzy, is that all right with you?
Yeah.
All right, so now, don't be freaking out about this. Think about what that says. It says y equals x plus 1, which would be a line, right? A line. But it says the only part that I want is where x is. -2. Won't that just be a point? It'll be the point -2, -1. Because it says y equals x plus 1, but x has to be -2. So even though there's a whole line there, I only want that little piece of it. Or that little thing. And that is a nice solid dot, so that's it for that one. And then... what is this? That's a parabola. Here is its point, which will be an open point. And I want that way, so I'll erase this. And there it is, Izzy. You can leave that squiggly in there, or you can take it out if you want. It's really not part of the graph.
Okay.
Okay, yonder?
Can I do one of the domain ones where it's like x squared minus 3 at the bottom?
So find the domain of like this?
Yeah.
What's on the top? It matters whether there's a radical or not. I mean, that would change things. The rule is if you have a denominator, it cannot be 0. So x squared minus 3 cannot be 0, so x squared can't be 3, and x can't be plus or minus root 3, which means, again, it helps me to look at a number line. You don't that domain. Negative infinity to negative root 3, or negative root 3 to root 3, or root 3 to infinity. Whoops. That would be my domain. Now, if we put a radical up there, now we have another problem to worry about. We still have this. We still have this to worry about. But now, whatever 5x plus 7 is, it has to be greater than or equal to 0. So x has to be greater than or equal to negative 7/5. Now, root 3 is 1.4. Check, what's root 3? Why am I pointing? 1.2? What's the square root 3?
1.732.
1.7, okay, so I'm way out. Okay, so it's 1.7. Oh, yeah, that makes sense. And 7/5 is negative 1.4. So now we have said that whatever x is, it has to be bigger than or equal to negative 1.4. So now my domain does not even include this part. This part's out. Now I'm going from negative 1.4 to root 3, or from root 3 to infinity. So there's two things you have to worry about. You have to worry about radicals and denominators. And then that'll give you your domain every time. All right, who else? Who else has a question? Abby?
Can you go to implicit functions like in general?
Yep, they're very, very easy. You're going to be given something that isn't a function, and you're going to be asked to break it up so that it is two little functions that when put together will make the big one. So it'll be some kind of equation like this. That is not a function, that is a sideways parabola. So, I pretend like I'm gonna put it into my calculator, which means it has to be y equals. So y equals the square root of 10 minus x, or the negative square root of 10 minus x. And those, that's it right there. That's what you would put into your calculator, and that's what would give you the shape. If you did both of them at the same time, that would give you the shape of the curve. Okay, so it's as easy as solve for x. Notice that these are exactly the same, except one's positive and one's negative. There's no difference otherwise. And also, if that had been a squared, and let's say that had been 100, please do not do anything freaky like 10 minus x, because you can't. These don't simplify. Okay? If there's an add or a subtract, you can't simplify a radical. So those would be the answers if that were a problem. Okay? All right, who else? Mr. Hollis?
I don't know if this will be on the test, but when is it going to be a neither instead of even and odd?
Oh, there are millions of them. Millions of them. So, yeah, the question could be, is this function even, odd, or neither? So, let's say we had y equals 2x squared plus 5x. Okay? I wonder if it's even, odd, or neither. Now, if it's one of my BFFs, I can probably do this without any work because I know what the BFF shapes are, and I know that even means symmetry about the y-axis, and odd means symmetry about the origin. So if someone gave me the absolute value function and said even, odd, or neither, I would say definitely even because it's symmetric about the y-axis, and that's what even means. If you have some random equation that you don't really know the shape of, then you're going to do your tests of symmetry. Who remembers what the test of symmetry for the y-axis is?
The square of the x.
Change the sign on x, yep. So we make this a negative x. And then simplify. So that is going to stay positive, but that's going to become negative. Is that the same as the original problem? Nope. So this is not even. This is no for even. Now, what's the test of symmetry for the origin? Change them both. So negative y, back to the original, negative y equals 2 negative x squared plus 5 negative x. So negative y equals 2x squared minus 5x. So y equals negative 2x squared plus 5x. Is that the same as the original? No. So it's not odd, which means it's a neither.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. Who else?
Usually, how do we determine the local and absolute integrity?
Those are maxes and mins, tops of hills, bottoms of valleys. So, we used our calculator on the thing you just did. But if I gave you the absolute value function and said, what are the extrema? There's only one. It's a minimum, and it's at 0, 0. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Extrema are maxes and mins, high points and low points. So if it's a BFF, you should know it. If it's something else weird, like the one on the quiz, then you'll just drop it on the calculator. All right. Well, you got plenty of practice work to do.